Well, greetings, programs. That's a Tron reference. See, if you're not a nerd like me, because I'm a big nerd, then you wouldn't understand and know all these nerd 80s references if you were my age or around my age. I guess, you know, I shouldn't say that because 80s has been experiencing sort of a resurgence lately. So a lot of young people are really into 80s stuff. I was talking to a guy the other day who was about my age, and he's talking about how his teenage daughter is wearing his old stupid 80s shit because she thinks it's cool. Weird how that works. But I am Caleb Jones, and this is the Alpha Male 2.0 podcast. And today I want to tell you a story, true story from my life, an important story. And there will be a very unusual and unexpected twist at the end of the story that will surprise you because it surprised me. Matter of fact, as I'm recording this, I am still surprised because this surprise just happened recently. So, and I apologize for the audio quality. Once again, I am in transit and I'll actually be in transit traveling a lot for next few months. It's nice to finally get back in the saddle again. I am at home when I'm traveling. I feel better when I'm traveling. So it's nice to experience that again after being locked down for so long because of stupid coronavirus. Or should I say stupid governments? But I digress. So when I was a kid, I did not have, with the exception of my dad, and he was barely an exception. I'll explain that in a second. But I did not have, like so many of you, any alpha male role models or of truly masculine alpha male men who I could look up to in my real life. Well, Caleb, what about your dad? Well, my dad, as I've talked about before, was an alpha male 1.0. He was a mild alpha male 1.0. But he was definitely an alpha male 1.0. He had his own business and he was very strong, very confident. But the challenge with my dad was that he worked at a job and then later, a little later when I was a small child still, started his own business. And it was a business that he hated. So he worked my entire childhood and adolescence until I moved out even after that at a business that he hated. And so he was an alpha male and he was reasonably masculine, but he would come home every day tired and pissed off. And the only time I saw him happy as a child was Saturdays, because that was the day he didn't have to work. And he would be pissed off again on Sunday because tomorrow was Monday. So I usually saw him worn out, touchy, pissed off. And I didn't equate that to a true masculine badass alpha male, that particular trait. Now, his other traits were very alpha. And so he was a role model to me in certain respects. So I'm not saying I was completely without role models. And obviously, the fact that I even had a dad put me at a great advantage as compared to a lot of men today. A lot of men today, perhaps even you, did not have a dad or were not raised with a dad or maybe a part-time dad or a beta male dad. Or so I'm not denigrating the scenario I had. I was very lucky. But outside of that, which didn't really, for some reason, just didn't do it for me, I did not have any hardcore alpha male role models in my life. The few men that I knew were betas or typical normal everyday guys, I did not know any alpha male. So I had to seek this hunger that I didn't know I had at the time as a child, as a boy. I had to seek that out through pop culture, specifically movies and TV shows. And when I was a kid in the 70s and 80s, the two role model alpha males that I glommed onto were, in this order, Indiana Jones in the Indiana Jones movies, which made a huge, huge, huge impact on me. Matter of fact, I could do an entire podcast on how important Raiders of the Lost Ark, how important that movie was to not only my childhood, but my life. Maybe I'll do that at some point. And the original Captain Kirk, the 1960s Captain Kirk. Those were the two men who I said, oh my God. And to a lesser extent, Han Solo. But Han Solo had a lot of flaws I didn't like, but he was very cool. So those were the two kind of alpha male role models I had as a kid. And I didn't know this at the time. I didn't know, oh, these are my alpha male masculine role models. But there's only so much, at least in my opinion, this is just how my brain works. There's only so much that an alpha male character in a movie or TV show that you're watching on a screen can do for you in terms of your life. So I still didn't have anyone in my life. Now that all changed when I was in about, I don't remember the exact age. I want to say fifth grade or sixth grade, which means how old was I? It was probably 10 years old, maybe 11, when I met my first real, hardcore, honest to God, alpha male. And I wrote a very brief article about this person many years ago where it was a very brief. I just touched on the basics. Today, I'm going to give you a lot more detail. This was my karate teacher, my sensei. So I started taking karate lessons as a kid, little kid. I mean, 10, 11 years old. I don't know if that's a little kid, but took, back then it was a Korean style Tang Soo Do Muduk Wan. And he was a fourth degree black belt in that style, plus some other styles as well, I believe. I'm not sure about that. But started going to karate classes and he was the teacher, and I had never seen or met a man like this. He was ripped. He wasn't tall. He wasn't a tall guy. He was probably shorter than I am now. It's hard to tell because I was such a kid back then, but I would guess he was probably 5'9", maybe 5'8", but ripped. Ripped, good, ripped guy. Really good looking guy. Handsome, square jaw, full head of dark hair, tan skin. He looked like an action hero from the 80s. He looked like a 1980s action hero. And he talked like a deep, you know, masculine voice. Sometimes I would spar, had to spar with him, which I didn't want to because he would kick my ass. But there were times I would spar with him, and every once in a while I'd punch him like in the stomach, and it was like punching a wall. His abs were just rock hard. Like, what the hell? And he was amazing. He was smiling. He would joke around. He would like shove guys and, you know, punch him in the shoulder. You know, one of those kind of guys. Masculine, tough guy. He had a background as a bodyguard and a bouncer. He had been in real life fights. Matter of fact, every once in a while, his voice would crack. He would say, okay, got to do a high block instead of saying a high block. And his voice would crack. And the reason for that is, he got in a real-life altercation where a guy kicked him in the throat. So he had scars and wounds because this guy had actually been in real combat. He wasn't just a karate guy. He really fought in the real world as a bouncer, bodyguard, various other jobs he took when he was younger. And he would do things like, yeah, I'm kind of sweaty. I'm going to go cool off. So he would just rip his clothes off down to his underwear and just jump into the lake. So the karate studio was right by a lake, and he would just hop over the fence and just jump into the lake and just swim in the lake and swim across the lake and swim back. And as a kid, as a sheltered young kid raised by a nun mother, literally, my mom was a nun before she married my dad, raised in a Catholic school, I had never seen a man like this. I had never seen a man so strong, so outcome independent, so happy, so masculine. He was a guy. Then one day, I mean, it kept getting better and better. I was in awe of this man. One day I would go to the, I remember going to the karate studio, and this woman was planting flowers outside of the karate studio, at least planting some, you know, flowers and stuff. And I glanced at her and she was gorgeous. She was like this blonde, hot, playboy playmate, amazing woman, physically fit, toned, big boobs, perfect hair, just gorgeous. And I'm like, holy crap. So then I walk in, I was talking to my buddies, like, who's the hot chick in the front of the fucking car? God damn, she's hot. Holy shit. And they're like, oh, that's Alan's wife. So he was not only an alpha male in terms of who he was, but in terms of his lifestyle. He was married to this gorgeous blonde babe. Interesting parallels for myself. But anyway, I mean, it's just on and on and on. And the energy that I got off this guy was so wonderful. And again, I want to repeat, as a kid, I didn't know that I had this need to connect with a masculine man or a masculine alpha male role model. I didn't know I had that need. I had that need, but I never defined it because I was a kid. I didn't know. Sometimes you don't know what you're missing. And I didn't realize that I had this hunger. And so I connected with this guy on many levels. He was fantastic. And I never got as close to him as I wanted to. But having him in my life made me understand, started to make me understand what it meant to be a man, a real man, an alpha male. And again, I didn't have the word alpha male in my lexicon. I didn't know what I was talking about. I was a kid. For the first time, I felt, okay, this is the kind of man that I can look up to, and this is the type of man that I want to be. Now, obviously, he was not an alpha male 2.0. Again, this is, you know, 40 years ago. I didn't have any of that terminology or lifestyle design systems down. I'm sure he was monogamous, although I'm sure he cheated because he's an alpha 1.0. He had location-dependent income, blah, 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 blah. But you see my point. This is many, many years ago. This is back in, you know, the 80s when this happened. And from then on, also, even in later in life, I would do things that I was subconsciously emulating from Alan. Certain mannerisms he would have, certain things he would say, the way he would carry himself. I noticed later in life that I had duplicated some of these mannerisms because that was the only real connection I had to a truly masculine alpha male as a child. And he was a huge influence on me, more than I realized at the time. He was a huge role model for me. He was, frankly, the only real, outside of my dad, aspects of my dad, I should say, he was the only real masculine role model I had until I was well into my late 20s. And when that's when I found guys like Brian Tracy and things like that. I've mentioned those guys before. But Brian Tracy was not necessarily an alpha male role model for me. He was just an overall role model for me. So I really didn't have any alpha male role models for many, many years after this guy. He was the only one, unfortunately. And frankly, if I had gone into sports, which I did not do in high school, if I had really gone out for sports and if I had continued karate, full contact stuff, into my later years, I'm sure I would have encountered other alpha males, but I didn't do that. I went into the business world instead. So there you go. I only had Alan around for about, I want to say 3 or 4 years. One day we went down to the karate studio and the lights were out and he was gone. He just left. He just skipped town. And we never really figured out why that happened. There was no warning. He just was gone one day. And I continued my karate stuff, my full contact stuff with some other teachers. And then eventually it fizzled out as I got more busy with my business life. But it was never really the same again without Alan, because Alan was such a key part of my motivation in that area of my life. As a matter of fact, I have a feeling that if Alan had stuck around, I would have pursued more fitness-oriented areas of my life. I mean, I really got into weight training and lifting weights as a teenager in addition to karate. So I really got into that. I thought that was really enjoyable. But again, I didn't have any alpha male, masculine weight training role models in my life. They were all betas or, you know, various versions of betas. And so it was interesting to think about what would have happened if he had stuck around in my life. And I don't know. We can only speculate. Throughout my adult life, I have thought back to Alan and thought back to the other role models that I've had when I was a younger man or as a kid. And invariably, my thoughts would always go back to Alan. So at one point a few years ago, I looked him up just curious to see what he was doing and found him on, I don't remember if I found him on Facebook. No, I didn't find him on Facebook. I found his website. He was still practicing karate. He was still teaching karate. He was still at it and he was an old man. He had white hair. But other than the fact that he had white hair, he looked the same. He was still ripped. He was still amazing looking. He had all these really cool pictures of himself, like on motorcycles and shit, you know, real masculine, cool shit, even though he was an old man, which is great. Matter of fact, today, my role models, and I've mentioned this before, I think, all of my role models today who I really think are amazing men, who I model my life after and consider as role models and or mentors, are old fuckers in their 70s. All my role models there are really, really, really old bastards in their 70s. Guys like Brian Tracy, guys like Jim Rogers, guys like that. So I have a soft spot in my heart for old men. but anyway, so just recently I was doing some writing and writing about some of the role models I had in my past. And Alan's name came up. I went, you know, I should look him up. You know what? Matter of fact, better look him up. I should call him up. And I should interview him for a podcast or something like that, just as like almost like a role model series that I should have on my YouTube channel or for this podcast or something like that. So I got excited. So I looked him up and hard to find him this time. I couldn't find any of his dojo information online. I couldn't find any of his websites online. Like, well, that's interesting. Did he retire? I mean, that wouldn't make a lot of sense. I can't really see a guy like that retiring, but maybe, I don't know. Couldn't find him. So finally found his last, I'm not going to say his last name, space karate da 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 on Facebook. And I'm like, well, is this him? Because maybe it's some other guy with the same last name. Poked around and sure enough found some pictures of him and some other black belt instructors at the karate studio. And I'm like, oh, cool, there he is. And you know, same deal. He definitely looked older, you know, more wrinkles and shit, but white hair, you know, chiseled, ripped, awesome. Fun pictures of him. I'm like, oh, this will be so cool. So click around and I noticed that there aren't a lot of posts on that Facebook page for his business. Well, that's strange. I mean, you know, karate studios usually have a lot of engagement because guys are really into that. A lot. Today, the cool thing is jujitsu. Jujitsu wasn't cool back in the 80s when I was a kid. Back in the 80s, it was more taekwondo and shit like that. I did tang sudo, which is similar. Taekwondo is more of a sport. Tang sudo is more of an art. By the way, side point, in terms of martial arts, tang sudo sucks. I didn't realize at the time, but in terms of karate styles that I would choose today, tang sudo, no. Tang sudo is very robotic. I don't like it at all. There are many other styles I'd be more interested in. There are many other styles that I would be more interested in terms of if I want to go back into martial arts, which, by the way, I do. In my 50s, I would like to get back into martial arts and get my black belt. So I got, just so you know, I'm deviating from the topic here a little bit, but who gives a fuck? I got to, in tang sudo, you have the belt order goes white, see if I can remember this, white, yellow belt, purple belt, green belt. There's three dan in green belt, three levels. And then there's three levels in red belt, and then it's black. And there's four levels in black, I believe. I think that's right. And I got to red belt. I got all the way to red, one away from black, before I stopped farting around with karate. And so all my life, I've had this nagging thing in the back of my head saying, Caleb, man, why didn't you get your black belt? You didn't get your black belt. So in my 50s, what I would like to do is finally go after my black belt. Not in tang sudo. I'm going to start from zero again. I will start at white belt. Just, you know, because I'm pretty out of practice. And pick some style. I don't care what it is. Jiu-jitsu, maybe. I haven't really decided. And go back for that. So anyway, getting back to the topic. Looking around for Alan. And can't find him. So I poke around some more. And finally, on Facebook, I find him. Alan, there he is. I'm like, is this really him? Oh, there he is. Yep, there's his picture. Looks good. All right, cool. So I start looking for contact information. Maybe I can find this guy. Call him up or something. At least send him an email or something. I didn't want to send him a message on Facebook until I knew the Facebook page was active. Because sometimes you can have people on Facebook where, I don't know if you've seen this, you find their Facebook page, younger people in particular, and the last posts were like 3 years ago. So they've basically been ignoring their Facebook page because they've gone to Instagram or just stopped using social media or what have you. And that's what I found here. I saw that on his Facebook feed, the last post was like mid-2017. So I'm like, God damn it. So I look around his pictures, really cool, fun pictures, him in a bandana on a motorcycle and camping and, you know, doing Tai Chi on a lake and kicking people's asses and, you know, shit like that. And then there's this one picture, one of the later pictures, where it's this picture of a guy who is very sick. He looked like a skeleton. This guy looked like a skeleton, like an emaciated skeleton laying in bed. And I'm thinking, God damn, is this must be his dad. Oh, this is really sad. This is horrible. Who the fuck is this? Why would you put a picture like this on your Facebook page? It's pretty terrible. I mean, it was really bad. I'm like, ugh. And it didn't match any of the other pictures on there. So I keep poking around, and I find another picture of this skeleton man who is laying in bed with a bunch of, you know, IV tubes coming out of him. It just looks horrible. I'm like, God damn. I mean, I realize this is his dad or best friend, but I don't know if I'd put that picture on my Facebook page. It's pretty disgusting. And then I see another picture of this man, and under the caption is a note from Alan. And the note under the picture says, hey, want to lose weight? Get cancer, smiley face. And I start looking at some more pictures, and I put it together. This was Alan. This is what happened to Alan. Alan got some kind of horrifically terrible cancer. And when I say this person, who didn't look like Alan at all, was emaciated, that's an understatement. This person looked like a living skeleton. Horrific. And my heart drops. I'm like, oh my God, you're kidding me. And I, just to verify, look at that picture, look at other pictures, and yeah, sure enough, it's him. And so I go back to the Facebook feed, look through the feed, and there's like this the last thing on the feed is this motivational quote. I forget what it was. And below that is a comment from one of Alan's friends. And the comment says something to the effect of, this was Alan's last post. Alan, you will be missed. And it was dated the summer of 2017. So Alan passed away 3 years ago. And by the looks of things, it was not an easy death. It was a very long, painful, slow, horrible death. And I just discovered this a few days ago. I'm still wrestling with how I feel about it. I haven't had a lot of people in my life die. I've had a few. And I have to remind myself that death is a part of life and that it's part of the human condition we can't really do anything about. And death is one of those things that makes me very upset. My death in particular. I want to live a very, very, very long time. I would love to live forever. I would totally take that pill in a heartbeat. It upsets me that you build up a life and then you just, it all ends someday because of biology, which sucks. And don't really know how to feel about it. He was someone very important in my life. I was actually getting very excited to talk to him again. And now I will never be able to do that. So I try to, when I encounter things like this in my life, derive lessons from it so I can learn from it instead of just being disappointed or sad or what have you. And the first lesson I pulled from this was, don't wait. Obviously, I waited way too long. I mean, not only did he passed years ago. That's bullshit. That's on me. I could have, and I did look him up several years ago. I mentioned this. Several years ago, I looked him up, and he was still alive and still fine. And I could have contacted him then, and maybe could have closed some loops. Would have been a very nice thing for me. And maybe a nice thing for him. Maybe not. Who knows? Maybe he couldn't even remember me. Maybe he didn't even remember me. It's entirely possible. I mean, teaching karate lessons for years and years and years and years, as many years as he did, the odds are high. He would have said, oh, who are you, Caleb? Oh, okay. I'll take your word for it. I don't really remember. And that would have been fine. That would have been fine for me. I'm Malcolm Independent. Don't really care. But that's on me that I waited that long because people don't live forever. I have this thing in my head because I live such a healthy lifestyle, more or less. And I focus on longevity and anti-aging and having a great alpha 2.0 life. I don't really think about death. It's not something I think about in terms of people, other people dying. I think about my death. Every once in a while, I think about, you know, when I'm 125, how will I go, blah, 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 blah. But it's not something I really think about because I live a very positive life. So it didn't even occur to me that maybe this person wouldn't even be alive today if I waited too long. So that was the first lesson is don't wait. Matter of fact, I thought about my own dad. My dad is in his 80s and he's still alive. And so that made me realize, hey, I better, you know, go see my dad a little more, especially in my case. I'm moving out of the country in a few months. My dad lives about 45 minutes north of me. I should probably go see him a few times before I go. So immediately I told Pink Firefly, I said, we're going to go visit my dad, you know, in a little while, maybe after Thanksgiving or something like that. And my mom too, and various other people I know, friends of mine, acquaintances, business acquaintances, things like that, who are older. Because again, like I said, a lot of my mentors, all of them actually are old, old bastards, old, old guys. Who are not going to be around forever. And so that was the first lesson I derived from this. Second lesson I derived from this was to treasure the memories and experiences that Alan gave me, things that I would not have had he not been there. And even I wonder strongly, thinking about this, how would my life have turned out in terms of Alpha Male 2.0 and all that other stuff if I had never met Alan? It's almost a scary thought. Now, I'd like to think it'd be more or less the same. And maybe it would be, but maybe not. Maybe it would have been different or even significantly different. So maybe his importance is something that is even beyond what I'm admitting here in this podcast. Maybe. I don't know. See, that's the other thing is that's the next lesson is you don't know who you touch and how you touch them. I have had guys contact me through Alpha Male 2.0 and say things like, I was going to kill myself. I bought the gun. I bought the bullets. And then I started reading The Unchained Man and you turned my life around. I have had multiple guys say to me at seminars I've done or emails I've received of guys saying, I never had a dad. You are the closest thing I've ever had to a father. I've had several guys tell me this. I have had to acknowledge that my content is serious stuff. I mean, I joke around a lot. I laugh a lot. I want you to laugh a lot too. But I had to realize maybe 2 or 3 years ago, a little longer than that actually, that this wasn't just a fun little money hobby for me. This is something that was very, very important and meant a lot to a lot of people. And what I'm telling you is that applies to you, even if you're not a public figure like I am. There are people that you have touched in a way that you don't understand you have touched them. There are lives that you have changed, even if you don't now understand them. Alan doesn't know and now will never know what he did for me. And how he changed my life. He didn't even know. And he'll never know. And you may not know the positive ways in which you have changed someone's life. And I will not know. I mean, I get a lot of positive feedback. It's very nice. But I will not know the extent to which I have helped people. Some men. Not all men, but some men. So you should be aware of this because it really makes you think through your actions when you realize or remember the effect you have on other people. I go out of my way, and there are times I don't like doing this, but I do this. I'm pretty good about this, and I'm pretty religious about this. I go out of my way to think through what I'm going to say, and certainly the topics I'm going to cover and the opinions I state publicly before I actually say them, because I've seen too many problems with too many other people in my position shoot their mouths off about things, either crazy opinions that are off topic to what they're discussing, or just random stupid shit, and they get in all kinds of trouble, A, B, and they send their audiences down the wrong directions. I've seen that a lot, and I don't want to do that to my audience, so because I remember the effect that I have on people, and you should remember the effect you have on people. By the way, that includes women you date, the women in your life. You're going to have, and you probably have had, a real effect on at least some of those women in terms of changing their lives forever, hopefully for the good. Maybe for the bad if you really fucked up, but hopefully for the good. I know that in my past, the past women I've been with, many of these women were able to pull off some pretty neat things with their lives. And it wasn't because of me, but I definitely had an influence. And these women told me this. So this applies to your personal life. That's why I'm talking to you about this, even though you may not be a public figure. The last lesson that I think is very important from this is to make sure you have at least, if you can, I know this is hard, if you can have at least one alpha male or semi-alpha male role model, older man in your life beyond someone like me you hear on the internet or see on YouTube videos or watch from afar. Ideally, someone in your actual life. It's invaluable. And I understand that that's hard. I understand that it may not even be an option in some cases because, as I talked about many times, alpha males are a dying breed. There are less and less and less of them every year. One of the reasons I tend to gravitate toward much older men is because they tend to be more alpha because they come from a bygone era. I was lucky in that I grew up in the 1980s where there were a lot of alpha males. Alpha males were all over the place. It was great. That's not true anymore. Unfortunately, it gets worse and worse every decade. I think it was Dan Pena who was talking about, he was saying, you know, I thought men back in the 90s were total pussies, but men in the 90s are fucking gladiators compared to men today in the 2020s. It's no comparison. And unfortunately, he's right. I've talked about that a lot. But regardless, you've got to do your best, if you can, to find at least one guy who is like that. And maybe if he's not a perfect masculine alpha male, that might be good enough. And I'm not saying alpha male 2.0, by the way, because you're not going to find one of those. Very unlikely. But you could certainly find maybe an alpha male 1.0 or worst case scenario, absolute worst case scenario, especially for your younger guys, a very masculine, more confident beta, a high-end beta male who's very masculine. You need masculine male role models in your life. By the way, if you do not have a dad, and I'm not talking to you just if you're a kid, I'm talking about you as an adult. If you don't have a dad, or a dad who raised you, or you have an estranged relationship with your dad, or your dad is a total beta pussy, this goes triple for you. You've got to tie into someone as best you can for that masculine energy, for lack of a better term. It's so important. And now at a bare minimum, you can do what I did, is that you can tie into my content, you can tie into other content providers who are alpha males, tie into their content, that's valuable. You can watch movies and TV shows and connect as best you can with some of the alpha male characters in those things. It's better than nothing. Matter of fact, I talk about that in The Unchained Man. It's better than nothing, and that does help. But ideally, if you can, try to find someone in your life who fills that role for you. If you can, and I realize it's hard. Well, Caleb, how do you do that? Boy, that's a big topic, and I'm not even an expert on that topic, and I don't think I have all the answers on that topic. That would be something maybe I'd have to interview someone else for. How to build social circles and how to find friends is not really my area of expertise, even though I get those questions a lot. One thing I can tell you or hint at is that we are working on something. Matter of fact, it's almost done, where you will be able to more easily network with other alpha male 2.0s in your individual cities. I had to delay that because of COVID, and I was going to release it in November, December timeframe. But now, particularly Europe and some states, the United States, the lockdowns have reappeared again because our governments are idiots. So I'm really not sure what to do about that. Maybe I should just do it anyway, and you guys can connect with each other virtually before you can connect with each other in real life. But anyway, regardless of when that happens, that is coming soon. Hopefully that will be helpful to you. But that's all I've got today. I hope this example has helped you. It was certainly a wake-up call for me. I'm still feeling a little bad about it. And feeling negative emotions is not something I experience very often. So this is kind of a new experience for me, going through that when I realized that Alan had passed away 3 years ago. But don't make the mistake I did. Don't wait. Find that role model, or at least something close to it. Tie into that as best you can. And just be aware of these things. And be aware of the effect you have on other people. I will see you very soon. I will see you in this podcast next week. Have a good one. Bye.